Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. Just to remind you, this lecture is being recorded for later viewing on YouTube, but if you want to see it live, of course, you've got to be here. The Eugene P. Wigner Distinguished Lecture Series in Science, Technology, and Policy was launched on the 4th of November, 2013, on the occasion of the 70th anniversary of what you might call the birth of the lab with the first criticality at the graphite reactor. It's organized by our corporate fellows, and the goals are to invigorate scientific discovery, spur technological innovation, and initiate productive scientific policy debate. And of course, with the naming, we're honoring Eugene Wigner, who is a kind of patron saint of Oak Ridge, chemical engineer by training, but a physicist by inclination. He was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1963. The announcement of that Nobel Prize actually occurred while he was in Oak Ridge, giving a lecture on the occasion of the 20th anniversary of first criticality at the graphite reactor. In 1963, the notification from Sweden was a little bit more involved, because of difficulties with long-distance phone calls and so forth. And then, of course, he had to rapidly take a train back home to Princeton. But anyway, he also founded the field of nuclear engineering and really serves as a role model for the coupling of basic and applied work, and laid the foundation during his brief tenure as research director of Oak Ridge, then called Clinton Labs, from 1940 to 46, when he developed what I think we'd call today the strategic plan for this new institution, and also led the effort for the planning of the facilities for what they then called the permanent lab, since, of course, the lab that they had in 1946 was the temporary lab, which you can go and see in all its glory in what we call the central campus, since, as we know, those temporary buildings weren't quite as temporary as everyone thought. So Alvin Weinberg, writing on Wigner's role in the Manhattan Project, said that when fission was discovered, Wigner was the classic case of the prepared mind. After all, he had by this time made many of the most central contributions to theoretical nuclear physics. These contributions included the realization that symmetries are the key to understanding and classifying the structure of matter. And in fact, he received the Nobel Prize for his contributions to the theory of the atomic nucleus and the elementary particles, particularly through the discovery and application of fundamental symmetry principles. The construction of the Standard Model and today's efforts that go beyond it build on Wigner's work in this area. Actually, interestingly, if you read Wigner's autobiographical musings, there's a book of kind of memories and essays that he dictated. He talks about the fact that he sort of got into the symmetry business because at that time it was regarded as kind of arcane and perhaps not so important. So he thought, I'll go look at this because no one else is paying attention to it, and it was obviously the right thing to do. Our speaker today is engaged in searching for new sources of symmetry violation. This includes an experiment to make a high-sensitivity measurement of the neutron electric dipole moment, taking advantage of the capabilities here at the spallation neutron source. Brad Filippone is the Francis L. Mosley Professor of Physics at Caltech, the California Institute of Technology. He received a BS from Pennsylvania State University, an MS and PhD from the University of Chicago, at a postdoctoral appointment at Argonne National Lab before joining Caltech in 1983 as a research fellow. He leads Caltech's Kellogg Radiation Laboratory, experimental research in nuclear physics, particle physics, and astrophysics. And in 2009, in recognition of his many contributions to nuclear astrophysics, nucleon spin structure, nuclear interactions at short distances, and fundamental symmetries, especially development of experimental techniques to meet these challenges, he was named a fellow of the American Physical Society. He's well known to us here at Oak Ridge. He served as a member of the Science Policy Committee for the Hollow Field Radioactive Ion Beam Facility from 2002 to 2005, as a member of the Proposal Review and Advisory Committee for the Fundamental Neutron Physics Beam Line at SNS since 2006. As I mentioned, he's the PI for the neutron EDM experiment at SNS, In his lecture today, he's going to discuss discovery opportunities at very low and very high energies. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Brad Filippone.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks for inviting me. I'm very happy to be here. I mentioned to Tom I take my jacket off because my students wouldn't recognize me. In fact, at Caltech, the only one who wears a jacket is the president on any given day. So today I would like to talk to you a little bit about the discovery opportunities in this symmetry area. I'll come back to this Wigner involvement again several times actually in this lecture. Looking for new physics, and we're doing this. It's actually not directly a collaboration, but an interaction of high energy physicists, nuclear physicists, and in some cases atomic physicists, all trying to attack the same physics. So that automatically suggests a wide range of energy scales, and so I will try to motivate how these energy scales can actually be attacked with these different fields and different energies, and what the scale of energies are involved. And we're going to see this is the picture of electric dipole moment at the very low energy end, and at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN at the very high energy end. So I mentioned in my abstract talking about gravity as one of the fundamental interactions. I won't say too much about gravity. I will say a little bit, but considering I come from Caltech, and we're only 2 days away from the first anniversary of the wonderful gravitational wave discovery. I had to recognize that anniversary coming just around the corner. Very exciting time, certainly at Caltech. So I'm talking about large energy scales. I mentioned in my abstract. I have here a logarithmic scale in energy, which I will come back to a number of times. At the high end, I should mention this is a scale of experimental physics. I'm an experimentalist. Physics also has theoretical physicists, and they sometimes work off beyond where anybody has any data. I will focus on the region where there is data, and I've done this in a unit of electron volts. So it spans from about 10 to the 14th electron volts, which is actually a collider that's being discussed for the future. The Large Hadron Collider is sitting here, and then we'll go from this energy. I'll start at this energy, and then we'll work our way all the way down to very low energies. And so I want to motivate first how these energy scales can be probed with how the physics that is being attacked at the Large Hadron Collider can be probed doing experiments at all these different energies. And so to do that, I got to pull out a couple of critical items from the physicist toolkit. The first one is the famous Heisenberg uncertainty principle. This is the one that's energy and time. What I want you to get from this is perhaps my only equation. I may have one other equation. If you have a very small time, so you pull the delta t over in the denominator, you can have a very big energy. Okay, for very short times, you can have very big energies. Get that concept. And the second concept is this is actually the Caltech lecture hall where I teach freshman and sophomore physics almost every year. And in this lecture hall, Feynman, it's the same lecture hall where Feynman taught. It's been renamed. It was a $1 million rehab just a couple years ago. But sitting up here in the corner is this little print here on the wall who's watching us when we're lecturing, which is pretty intimidating. But it shows Feynman here with one of his diagrams. And in this diagram, there are particles coming in, particles going out, and there's this thing in the middle. This thing in the middle is what's called a virtual particle. And you tie these two things together for very short times, which is the time scale for which virtual particles are produced, you can have very high energies. And so, for example, a virtual particle, you could have a relative, this is a quark here, a relatively light quark can be walking along and then flicker for a very short time into a quark plus, in this case, a Higgs boson, the big discovery from Large Hadron Collider. This Higgs boson is many thousands of times more heavy than the quark, but because it exists for a very short time, that energy is allowed to occur, that little flicker of energy. Also, more commonly, a photon, a regular photon, can flicker into an electron and an anti-electron, a positron, and then those two can then re-annihilate, disappear, and the photon comes out. And these sorts of processes, these little flickerings, can show up in low energy process and influence what the results will be from a given measurement. And so understanding Feynman realized. Think of it in a mathematical way. There's some mathematical formula. There's lots of terms in your formula, and he thought of these terms in terms of these little diagrams. And that was such a wonderful tool for physicists, especially for experimentalists, to understand what's going on. I have over here the particles that are in the standard model. We'll see various ones. There's the quarks, there's the electron, muon, tau, and the neutrino, leptons. The force carriers, strong force carrier, the gluon. The photon carries the electromagnetic force. And then these two Z and W bosons carry the weak force. And then there's this Higgs boson, the thing that was recently discovered, which is supposed to couple. It's charge, if you like, is the mass of a particle. So the more massive, the strong, it's like the electric charge. The bigger the electric charge, the bigger the force between two particles. In the Higgs case, it likes to interact to particles which have lots of mass. And so here are some very simple Feynman diagrams. And here are some more complicated diagrams. This is actually Feynman and his family with their van. He had a Dodge van done up with Feynman diagrams. And actually, for my first several years at Caltech, it was in the parking lot across the street. He drove it in until his daughter got old enough. She started driving it to school. But it was great to see the diagrams. In fact, it's the van was in an episode of Big Bang Theory, I believe, and it's been recently restored just a couple of years ago. So it still exists. But it's a wonderful little. Actually, they said the diagrams were really poorly done. That they, when they redid it, they had to actually peel them off. They couldn't restore it because it was a very simple job to put them on. But yeah, it was there for many, many years. I think it's a 75 van. So more complicated diagram. I pick one here to show how the Higgs boson at the Large Hadron Collider was discovered. They have a proton and another proton here. The protons have some quarks in them. In this case, one proton has a d quark, which turns into an up quark and spits out one of these W bosons. The other proton does the same thing, but a W plus. Those two particles, which are massive, then couple to a Higgs. So I produce a Higgs, and now I want to detect the Higgs. And so what happens, at some point, the Higgs can fluctuate, flicker into virtual particles. In this case, a very heavy top quark, an anti-quark and a top quark. And then the top quark spits out a photon. And this is a real particle. This particle is a particle that can be detected. It lives for a long time. Same thing for this photon, whereas these particles are just flickering on and off. Then you detect these two particles. The two photons then carry information about that Higgs particle, the mass of it. If you take the energy of the two photons and their directions, their momenta, you can calculate in the frame of the particle that was produced how heavy it was. Okay? So there'll be lots of photons. You look in your experiment, you see photons from many, many interactions. What you're looking for is you add the momentum and the energy just right and see if there are any that add up to a particular mass. That would be the evidence for your new particle. And that's what they did at the Large Hadron Collider. So here's the collider that straddles France and Switzerland. And this is a picture from one of the experiments, from the ATLAS experiment, of a collision that led to observation of the Higgs boson. And here's a picture of some of the data from the ATLAS discovery of the Higgs. What you see, this is the data as measured, and you see lots and lots of photons as a function of energy, but then there's a little bit of excess at this place. And so what they do is they try to characterize this underlying line here and see what's left, and they get this bump at 126 GeV, and that's the discovery of the Higgs boson. So this was a major discovery. You may, if you follow the news, you may also have heard that a year ago there was some evidence of a new particle as well at CERN, It was the same idea. You have the number of photons as a function of energy, and there appears to be a little blip in one of the experiments. This is the ATLAS experiment. There are two large experiments at LHC doing proton-proton collisions. I should mention there's actually a group here at Oak Ridge involved in the heavy ion program at the Large Hadron Collider in the physics division. But these are the two main experiments doing proton-proton collisions, looking for the Higgs and new physics. Both experiments saw a little bit extra at an energy about six times heavier than the Higgs, out here at 750 giga electron volts. This is suspicious, suggestive, there's a little excess. So they actually, the accelerator then turned back on this year with more energy. This is how physics works. You take more data, is it really there? They never said this was enough events above a background to say there was an observation, a discovery. And in fact, in both cases, they got a little less when they add the new data, include the new data. There's actually no evidence of an excess. And so this was just in August they announced last month that the excess appears to have disappeared. And so there's no additional new particles. So it looks like that standard model, so that picture, that box I showed you of the particles, all those particles are now observed, they're discovered, there's nothing new. It looks like the standard model's in great shape. However, at least from the theoretical point of view, there may be a little problem. So the experimentalists are in good shape, but the theorists tell us that the Higgs boson mass is actually, even though it's way out here, is too small. Why is it small? It's one of the heaviest particles in the list. Why is it too small? Well, they say it couples to mass. And if you look at all of the interactions, you start with the electromagnetic interaction. As you go up in energy, all the interactions get weaker and weaker. So actually around here, the electromagnetic force and the weak force have roughly the same interaction. They become unified, we say. And we believe that those two interactions will at higher and higher energies, the strong force will get weaker and become the same as the electromagnetic and the weak force at higher energies. And then at very high energies, those forces will have the same strength as gravity. They will get so weak, they will have the same strength as gravity, which is the weakest force that we know. In fact, but that occurs somewhere, you can't see my pointer, but somewhere over here, some many, many orders of magnitude up here, is where that unification, which we can't access in anybody's sensible lifetime. And so what has that got to do? Well, they say, well, anytime the theorists try to calculate, or they can't calculate, they try to estimate the Higgs mass, and these funny flickerings that occur from physics way up here keep pulling the Higgs mass to higher and higher energy. And so they say it should have been way up here. Why is it here? It's weird. It doesn't make sense unless something going on out here has been very carefully tuned. You take just the right coupling here and there and masses and everything. They don't, it's not what physicists, what theorists like to say, it's not natural to have this mass way down here. So something is wrong. So is there a possibility to fix that? And actually one of the solutions comes back to our namesake, E.P. Wigner, who, as Tom mentioned, this is the announcement of the Nobel Prize for contributions to the nuclear physics and elementary particles and the fundamental symmetries principle. And so this idea of symmetries being a critical part of quantum mechanics was one of the main contributions of Wigner. So this is actually, I went to his lecture, his Nobel lecture, which was very nice. And the title is Events, Laws of Nature, and Invariance Principles. And so what he tried to do was to relate what physicists do to try to understand the elementary interactions. And they start with events, which are really measurements. So it's what experimentalists do. You take the measurements, you look at the measurements, and he discussed these first two as sort of the raw materials or as the fuel for making advances in physics. So you take the measurements and you look at the measurements and they come together in some sort of laws of nature. So you develop Newton's laws. So you have the laws of nature or the Schrodinger equation in quantum mechanics. And then you look at the laws and you say, they have these interesting properties. If I change something, the state or the process also exists. So if I have, for example, two particles coming together and two particles coming out, the reverse process where those two different particles come in and the original particles come out, the time turning time backwards should have the same probability, at least according to the equations. That's a symmetry principle. And so this idea of the laws of nature being the raw materials for symmetries and invariance principles was a main contribution of Wigner. In particular, he was focusing on isospin symmetry, which is a part of the strong force, which says if you turn off everything else, the proton and neutron have the same strong interaction, even though they're totally different. The proton has a charge and the neutron doesn't. It's that the difference is really the electromagnetic part. If you turn that off, if you could, the strong interaction would be identical for the two. Also, another kind of symmetry, if the system looks the same as you rotate yourself around and around, that rotational symmetry of the system suggests that angular momentum is conserved. And so there's another symmetry of the system in this rotation. He also talked, and I'll come back to these later, mirror symmetry. If you take the coordinates x, y, and z and convert them all to minus x, minus y, and minus z, the process should also exist and should be visible. And I mentioned earlier time symmetry. So he contributed this idea of symmetries in quantum mechanics. And so the question is there a way to fix this problem with the Higgs particle being too light using symmetries? In fact, over the last 15 or 20 years, theoretical physicists have developed a way of fixing this problem. You need new particles to bring the Higgs boson mass close to where we actually observe it. And these new particles must cancel the effects of the particles that we know about. And so they said, well, maybe there's a new symmetry principle, and they called it supersymmetry. And the supersymmetry takes the particles that I showed before and makes a mirror set of particles called Susie particles, which have not been observed. But presumably, in order to make the Higgs boson where I showed you, they have to be a little bit heavier than the Higgs. So just above where the Higgs is. So maybe the idea was maybe just up here, which is the energy of the Large Hadron Collider, which is one of the main motivations of the Large Hadron Collider, besides finding the Higgs, was to see if there are new particles at that energy. So searching for these new particles up here. And the fact, at least up to now, they are now at 14 TeV, which is this 10 to the 13 EV. There is no evidence. They will run for a couple more years, certainly probably 10 years. But now they're thinking maybe we do have to go, we ought to go a little further. And so you can say, yeah, how do we find these particles? We can go higher. You can imagine it gets more expensive and more difficult to go higher. That you saw the size of the Large Hadron Collider. You have to go bigger if you want to go to higher energies. So there is another option. You can also go to lower energies and look for the existence of new particles through this flickering of virtual particles. And so I'm going to take us from the Large Hadron Collider. This is the proton rest mass, just sets a scale for how heavy the proton is. I'm going to talk about a couple of experiments. Each of these has a very close connection to the lab here. I'll talk about the neutron beta decay itself. I'll talk about neutrinos, and I'll talk about this electric dipole moment that Tom mentioned at the beginning. And so we'll cover this quite a huge range of energy scales and show how it relates to the new physics possible at very high energies. So the first case is neutron decay. Neutron has a lifetime of about 15 minutes. And when it decays, it decays to a proton, to an electron, and to an antineutrino. And at the quark level, or at the elementary particle level, we view that as the down quark turning into an up quark and producing this flickering W boson, which is not observable. It just lives for a very short time. That then decays to an electron and an antineutrino. So we see those particles. And so that's what happens in neutron decay. So you measure neutron decay. Your standard model tells you what the lifetime and what the decay, how the decay particles should come out. It predicts it beautifully. So now you start measuring it. Does what you measure agree with what you predict? And one way it might not is if this is not the whole story. If, for example, that down quark, this is the down quark here, if that down quark flickered into a couple of new particles, before the W appears and then the electron and the antineutrino, this would modify this process. And so when you measure the neutron lifetime and you measure the decay distributions, you'd get the wrong answer using the standard model. You'd measure it in the experiment and it would disagree. And that would be evidence of something funny going on in here. There are a number of experiments in the US attacking this, also in Europe. In the US, there's the UCNA and UCN Tau experiments at Los Alamos National Lab. I'm actually involved in the UCNA experiment. There's a neutron beam lifetime experiment to measure the lifetime with high precision at the National Institutes of Standards and Technology. And here at the SNS, in the near future, will be the NAB experiment. So the NAB experiment takes place. This is the end station. Takes place at beamline 13, the fundamental neutron physics beamline. With Jeff Green's leadership, the Department of Energy funded a beamline just for nuclear physicists to study these fundamental symmetries. And so that's going on with two experiments already completed, and the next one is this NAB experiment, the NAB experiment. So what's that experiment going to do? It's actually going to take a cold neutron beam and pass it through a magnetic spectrometer. And some fraction of the time, as the cold neutrons go through, they will decay. And it's going to measure the particles that come out of the decay with high precision. You measure the directional correlations, and you measure the energy of the particles coming out very precisely. And you can compare it again to what the standard model predicts and see if it agrees or not. And so there's this big magnetic spectrometer, and they'll study two correlations. So the name of the experiment, neutron, and then there's a little a correlation having to do with the correlation. What they measure is the proton going in one direction and the electron going in the other direction. They see how many times that happens, or if they both go in the same direction. That's predicted in the standard model. And then measuring the energy spectrum very precisely, they can get another coefficient called the Fiertz interference term, which is the little b. The group of experiments of institutions involved is shown here. You'll see all of the experiments I will discuss, the neutrons and the neutrinos and even the electric dipole moment, they're all sort of the same scale. There's something like 15 or 20 institutions, 50 to 80 people doing it. So it's a smaller scale that the LHC has thousands of people on a collaboration, 2,000-3,000 people on the collaboration. These are sort of smaller scale experiments. In some cases, this particular experiment is funded by the nuclear physics program of DOE and NSF as well. But some of the other experiments I'll discuss are also funded by high energy physics. You see, both of these fields are involved. In fact, there's a subfield in nuclear physics which we call fundamental symmetries now, which is tasked with addressing these questions. So now let me move to down in energy. We were at the neutron beta decay at 10 to the 6 electron volts. Now I'll go down 7 orders of magnitude to the neutrino rest mass, the mass of a neutrino. Which, by the way, was awarded a Nobel Prize just last year for the discovery of that mass and around at least a real confirmation in 2000, about 15 years ago. They were awarded the prize for discovering that neutrinos actually have mass. And they do that. Neutrinos are kind of strange. They have very interesting properties. The access to new physics I wanted to mention first. So there's this huge gap. Notice, so physicists, like we said, Wigner said, here's the events, and now you figure out the laws and then see if there's any symmetry. So you've got essentially all of the particles that we know about on that picture are either massless, like the photon, or they all have mass around here. Except along come the neutrinos way down here. So there's another puzzle, like I said, with the Higgs. Why are the neutrinos so light? And of course, the theorists have an answer for many of these tough issues. One of the favorite ones for understanding very, very small masses for the neutrinos is something called the seesaw mechanism. There's a little seesaw here. There's a light neutrino here, and there's a heavy neutrino here. The neutrinos that we observe could result from the standard particles. You pick some particle mass up here, the electron or proton, you put it here. Then you divide again by some big, there's another stuff going on way out here which we can't measure, but there's some mass out here which then you put in the denominator, and then this mass becomes very small. Okay, so this seesaw mechanism is a way of potentially bring new physics in to explain why neutrinos are so light. And so neutrinos, as I said, have masses. This bottom row is the neutrinos. There are three flavors. We characterize the flavors based on whether it's associated with an electron, a muon, or a tau particle. These are charged particles. These are neutral. The thing about the neutrinos is that when they move through space, they don't move through in the same flavor that they were created. They get created by the weak interaction in a particular flavor. But when they move through space, they participate as a different set of states in quantum mechanics. They get mixed up. And so this mixing up as they travel through space causes what was originally electron neutrino to later on look like a mu neutrino or to look like a tau neutrino. And so this mixing can only happen if they have mass. That causes a separation in space. Because I'm looking here and it's definitely electron neutrino, but then when I come over here, there's some chance that it's a muon neutrino, and then farther away maybe it's a tau neutrino. And so this idea of measuring the oscillations of neutrinos is how the neutrino mass was discovered. But so the Nobel Prize went for discovering neutrino mass, but not for measuring neutrino mass, because we don't know what any of the neutrinos' actual mass is. We just know that they have it. But it's actually, we have it constrained. The picture that I have is actually, we know it's in this range with a little bit of fuzziness, but not too much fuzziness. And that's because we know from the oscillations, we can tell the differences in the masses. And we know from laboratory measurements and also from cosmology, looking at the structure of the cosmic, both galaxy structure and cosmic microwave background, the early universe tells us there were certain things pulling the structure together, and neutrinos can play a role there. In fact, that helps us constrain. If the neutrinos are too massive or too heavy, if the scale of this mass, what's the bottom level? We know this difference, but what's the bottom level? If it's too high, then you get the wrong answer for the cosmic structure. And so we have some limit on what that might be. And so that sort of sets the scale, like I said, about 10 to the minus 1 electron volts. And so the laboratory here is actively involved in these neutrino experiments. In fact, I found this on the website just from a few weeks ago, discussing the major role of the laboratory in these neutrino experiments, providing experts and equipment to explore the unknown. So I'm going to talk about a couple of the experiments that are underway here to explore properties of neutrinos. Two of them are actually taking their data here on site. There's the coherent experiment at SNS, and then there's the prospect experiment at Heifer. And the group size is comparable to what I showed you for the NAB experiment. And to get my bearings, I have a site map so I can see where coherent. NAB is also at SNS. Coherent is located in the basement of SNS. There's a place in the basement. They're measuring a very weak process, and so they're worried about backgrounds from cosmic rays coming from outside. And so being underground helps a little bit. So they exist in the best place they have identified is the basement at SNS, and then Prospect is the preliminary. Apparatus is, I guess, just moved out of Heifer, and I'm looking forward to it. I have not been to Heifer before, but I believe that's on my list to see today, so I'm looking forward to that. And Prospect is an experiment at Heifer. So what are these experiments doing? So the coherent experiment is actually doing a very simple process. You have a neutrino comes in, it interacts with a nucleus, and then comes out as a neutrino. It's a billiard ball scattering, a neutrino billiard ball scattering from a nucleus. Turns out this process has never been observed. It's such a low probability, it's very, very hard to see. However, it's one of the main processes of how neutrinos interact in supernova, so we would like to confirm that the cross-section is actually what it is. And in fact, again, like I was describing before, if it turns out to be different than what the standard model says, then we have evidence again for new physics. And so the experiment hopes to measure the first ever coherent scattering. The energy of the neutrinos from the SNS, it's actually, there are lots of pions produced when the proton crashes in the splation target. The pions can stop and then decay. When they decay, they emit neutrinos, and these neutrinos can be detected. And the timing of the SNS really helps in identifying the neutrinos from just stuff coming in from cosmic rays. And so they'll run the experiment with multiple detectors. Multiple detectors means different nuclei. You have different nuclei here. Standard model tells you what the cross-section should be. You see if it's the same or not. And also you test this cross-section for supernova. The prospect experiment is again looking for antineutrinos, in this case from a reactor, the HIFA reactor, and they want to measure very precisely the energy spectrum of the neutrinos. What are the energies of the neutrinos coming out? The energy of the neutrinos coming out depends on all the fission products that are left over from the energy producing and energy production in the reactor. But measuring the spectrum of the neutrinos, again, the neutrino that's produced in the reactor, if you back away from it, the neutrino can oscillate into a different neutrino. And so reactor neutrino oscillations have actually been observed, and that was discussed earlier. And so the question is, there is some data that suggests that, so the oscillations are understood, the three neutrinos oscillate into each other, okay? There is a little bit of tension. We call it tension in the physics community when experiments don't quite agree with what we expect. And it looks like the spectrum, the flux of the neutrinos coming from the reactor, at least measured so far at a certain distance. You can't get too close. It's hard to get close to the reactor because of the background. So the some of the experiments have been done kilometers away, in some cases many kilometers away. In Diabei, China, they measured neutrinos from many reactors, multi gigawatts of reactors, and they measure the spectrum. And there's a problem. It appears to be at the sort of 5% level. It's called the reactor anomaly, these missing neutrinos. It's possible that the neutrinos, the electron antineutrinos produced from the reactor, are oscillating into something else. But we've already counted all the other neutrinos. So what can they be oscillating to? We already understand it's not the electron can't oscillate to a muon or tau because it's too short. It can't happen over a short distance. So what's going on? It could be a new fourth neutrino. The fact that we don't see that fourth neutrino lends us to think it's perhaps doesn't get involved. Maybe it's not playing a role in the weak interaction. So it's called a sterile neutrino because it doesn't potentially contribute. And so this oscillation to a sterile neutrino, again, is beyond the standard model. And they are looking for that by doing careful measurements of the spectrums of the neutrino scatter. They do actually the inverse of the neutron decay to detect them. And they can use the energy deposited to know the energy of the neutrinos. And so they'll measure that very precisely. So now there's another aspect of neutrinos where beyond standard model physics comes in. And in order to discuss that and also to discuss the physics that is addressed by electric dipole moments, I have to bring E.P. Wigner back in again and discuss. I mentioned a couple of his symmetry properties. And in his lecture, he has in a couple of places discusses the mirror image of that state. The mirror image is this what's called parity symmetry, where if you have a vector going in the x direction, there's also a process where the vector is going in the minus x direction. And so the parity is called mirror symmetry. He viewed one of his main contributions was saying that these symmetries are actually operators in quantum mechanics. What's an operator? It's just a mathematical thing. You hit the wave function with this operator, and it changes it. So you get a change in the wave function to xyz to minus xyz. Time reversal, you hit the wave function, you get the wave function for the time going backwards. You have time going forward and time going backwards. Both states, if these symmetries are good symmetries, both states should be visible in the natural world. There's a third, what's called discrete symmetry. It's called a discrete symmetry. What does that mean? It's because some of the symmetries I mentioned, rotation, I can do rotational symmetry to understand conservation of angular momentum. Rotational symmetry, I can make a tiny rotation, infinitesimal rotations. For these symmetries, I can't make a tiny change of xyz to minus xyz. It's a complete shift. And so these are called discrete symmetries, where time goes to minus time. The third one, charge conjugation, a particle is transformed into its antiparticles. And so these are the three discrete symmetries which may or may not be respected by the laws of the forces of physics. In fact, part of what led to his Nobel Prize several years earlier, parity symmetry was predicted and then discovered to be broken or violated by the weak interaction. And so the parity symmetry appears to be good for the strong force, but not for the weak force. So it's invalid for the weak force. And so we're trying to understand which symmetries play a role for which force. Oops. We believe, we talk to our theorist friends, they say it's almost impossible, even though some symmetries can be true in some forces, any kind of quantum force that we write down in the way we know how to do it, it seems to respect the multiplicative symmetry, which you first hit the wave function with T, then you hit it with P, and then you hit it with C. So that triple product appears to be a good symmetry for everything. So theorists, at least, and we're still testing it. Experimentalists, we have to go out and test it, and that's being tested. But so far, that no interaction seems to violate that symmetry. And so these symmetries are interesting. How do they play a role in physics or in terms of standard model? There's in fact another problem with the standard model, which it cannot answer, and that has to do with what happens in the Big Bang. So Big Bang, lots of energy. We mentioned before that a photon can turn into a particle and antiparticle, so you can have matter and antimatter, and they can also annihilate back into photons. So in the early universe, you expect to have lots of matter and antimatter just popping out because there's so much energy. These photons can decay to electrons and positrons, protons and antiprotons, neutrons and antineutrons, et cetera, et cetera. And so if it's all energy at the beginning, you should have equal amounts of matter and antimatter in the universe. But if you go out and look, the easiest way to look is a galaxy. So when matter and antimatter get together, there's a, if you've read the some novels, Dan Brown, I guess, had one of them. There's a lot of action, a big explosion, because the energy, that mass energy of the particles gets converted into photons. And so that annihilation would produce lots of fireworks. If, for example, you had a galaxy, which there are plenty of times we see galaxies colliding. If you had an antimatter galaxy and a galaxy colliding, you'd see a gigantic fireworks show in the cosmos. We don't see that. You also can just look at the particles coming from space. And largely the particles we see, if we can get above the atmosphere, so they're not modified by the atmosphere, are more matter than antimatter. We don't see a lot of antiprotons or antideuterons or anti-lithium coming from outer space. So where did all this stuff go? Why is there only matter and not just antimatter? So in fact, the observation is there's very little antimatter left over from the Big Bang compared to matter. So where did it all go? So that was it's always been a puzzle. There is a potential solution suggested by Andrei Sakharov, actually got the Peace Nobel in 75, for how to make the antimatter go away. We'd like it to go away somehow in a natural way in the early universe. And he said, well, it can work. We can make it happen if the total number of quarks can change. So a total number of quarks means if, say, a proton turns into a pi on an electron, the number of quarks is different. So the number of quarks must change. This is actually possible at very high temperatures in the standard model. The theorists say this can happen. Nobody's observed it, but they say it's totally possible in the standard model. It's part of the standard model. So you can get this. You need a departure from thermal equilibrium. That means somewhere something weird. You can't have equal temperatures over everything. You need something weird to happen. That happens in a phase transition. We anticipate there are multiple phase transitions in the early universe. When the quarks and the gluons, for example, become protons and neutrons, or when the weak interaction breaks from the electromagnetic interaction, multiple phase transitions. So this is okay. Then he said you also need, back to Wigner's symmetries, you need the product of C times P and C to be violated. If you can have all three of these things, it can explain through particle decays why most of the matter survived. Oh, sorry, most of the matter is gone. It annihilated with lots, but a tiny bit extra matter survived compared to antimatter. So now we see only the matter because all of the antimatter got eaten by matter. And so you need this charge parity symmetry violation, and you need charge conjugation violation, the C. Both of these are violated in the weak interaction. The weak interaction has a big C violation and a very small charge parity violation. That's observed, but it's too small. The amount of charge parity we see in the standard model cannot explain why the early universe should end up having more matter. So there's a question is, where is this new charge parity symmetry violation existing in nature? A natural place, we certainly thought the supersymmetry, where all these new particles that I described, this whole set of new particles, they could easily have, the theorists again tell us, there's lots of places where this violation could occur with these new particles. And so if those particles existed just at the level slightly higher than the Large Hadron Collider, then I would have plenty of CP charge parity violation to explain why the matter survived and the antimatter disappeared. And so there's active searches for this new CP violation. In order to do that, we need some sort of particles or interactions to provide it, and the neutrinos may be a solution. As I mentioned, the neutrinos mix with each other. This mixing, this quantum mixing, naturally allows a little bit of, or potentially a lot of, charge parity symmetry. And so the mixing of neutrinos could be a way of producing this. In order to look for this, there's an experiment that the Fermi lab is shooting a neutrino beam through the Earth into a former gold mine. It's actually the Sanford Underground facility, but it's the Homestead gold mine where neutrinos from the sun were first detected by Ray Davis in the 60s, actually. And so those neutrinos DUNE is the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment. So that experiment is going to look for this charge parity violation. But in order for the work, we mentioned we're talking about matter and antimatter. In order for that picture to work, not only do the neutrinos have to have this charge parity violation, they also have to have this other weird property. They must also, since neutrinos are neutral, in principle, a neutrino could be its own antiparticle. That's sort of a strange situation, but it's not ruled out by physics. That's called a Majorana particle. So if the neutrino is a Majorana particle and has this charge parity, it could explain why the antimatter is gone. And so in order to attack this problem of measuring the property of the neutrino, one way to do that, one of the most sensitive ways to do that, is from nuclear beta decay. Standard beta decay, like the neutron or any nucleus, an electron comes out, say, in an antineutrino. In some cases, this process is not possible, not energetically possible. But what can happen is, say, two neutrons. This is a neutron changing into a proton inside the nucleus. Two neutrons in the nucleus could change to two protons in the nucleus. That's energetically possible. And then two electrons and two neutrinos, antineutrinos, can come out. And so that process is predicted. It's very small because I have two weak processes have to happen at the same time. So it's very unlikely, but it can happen. This doesn't suggest that neutrinos are a Majorana particle. However, if also this process where the neutrino comes out, turns into a neutrino and then can be reabsorbed and no neutrinos come out, that's evidence for a Majorana particle. So the neutrino would be a Majorana particle if we could detect this. So how am I going to see this? Well, these two experiments, so the decay is a particle, a nucleus goes from a particular energy state to a different nucleus with a different energy state, so there's a well-defined amount of energy that's released. And so in this case, the four particles all share the energy. Neutrinos, you're never gonna be able to measure their energy precisely for these events and catch them with the electrons, so it's very hard to measure the total energy here. The energy of the sum energy of the two electrons, which is easy to measure, is always less than the total energy. In this case, there's no neutrinos, so the sum energy of the two electrons is equal to that energy difference between the two mass states, the initial and the final nucleus. And so this is a very characteristic signature. It's a big peak in measuring the energy response of the electrons, the energy of the electrons. And so there is an active worldwide effort looking for this so-called neutrinoless double beta decay, no neutrinos coming out. As I said, the signature is a peak in the summed energy of the two electrons. One of the key experiments in the US is the Majorana demonstrator, where the physics division is a very active player in this experiment. The demonstrator experiment is to set the stage. We don't think that the demonstrator, it's kind of like LIGO. LIGO had this initial stage where all the experts said they're never going to see anything, but we have to do the first stage in order to do the second stage. And so the NSF was gutsy enough to say, okay, go ahead and do the first stage. You know, that maybe something weird would happen, but they didn't see anything. For many, many years, they didn't see anything. Then they built this advanced LIGO, which is the sensitivity that they thought they would routinely think, and they did. Again, the Majorana demonstrator is probably not sensitive enough, but it demonstrates the technology, and then you would start a much bigger experiment, which is what the U.S.'s nuclear physics, at least, has said we would like to do a much bigger experiment to actually find this neutrinoless double beta decay. So Majorana demonstrator is underway to prove that they can, in fact, it is, I believe, billed as the most ultra-clean radiation detector that exists. Ultra-clean means if you have any other sort of radioactive material in it, there's plenty of radioactive material in the walls here, in rocks, radium, radon, everywhere. You have to make sure all that stuff is not there. That will produce a signal in your detector which will hide this nice neutrinoless double beta decay event. And so we need a very clean. The problem is the process is very rare. It occurs for one nucleus once every 10 to the 27 years is the half-life for the decay. And so you need many large amounts of the material so that you have a hope of one of those. In fact, they're looking for one or two or three. A very small number of these decays is all they hope to see. But then it will be so clean at peak that it's unambiguous. And so you have to remove all the possible background signals. The Majorana demonstrator is a fairly large collaboration, but on the order of 20 institutions, from including the lab LMN. There it is, right there, Oak Ridge. Including the lab, and so they're one of the main experiments that are pushing to produce the next level. We call it the ton. We need about a ton of material to actually detect it. These experiments underway now are sort of tens to 100 kilograms. We want to go to a ton of material in order to see the process. And there we think we have a chance. So now let me go. We've talked about the energies here. We want to now take a big jump from the neutrinos down to the neutron electric dipole moment scale energy. And this energy scale comes about if you take the neutron's electric dipole moment and the energy for a dipole moment, electromagnetic dipole moment in an electric field is just the product of the moment times the electric field. So if you take the present, people have searched for the electric dipole, which I'll discuss in a minute. If you take the limit on it and the electric field that was available, it's probably about here is where the limit is. The new experiments are trying to push it down to here. This is the range here where, as you'll see, we're also trying to account for this matter-antimatter asymmetry in the early universe using electric dipole moment. And so this energy is characterized by the dipole moment times the electric field, and that's 10 to the minus 23 eV. So what does the electric dipole moment have to do with the physics that I've described up to now? Turns out that the electric dipole moment violates this time symmetry. So if you break the time symmetry, remember we said C times P times T has to be preserved, at least that's what the theorists tell us. So if T is broken, then C times P is broken. We have a new source of CP violation. So the CP violation could from the quark sector, this would be quarks or neutrons, the neutrons or protons or the quarks inside them, could explain why there's more matter in the universe than antimatter. And you can see this if you have a neutron with its spin angular momentum in this direction. If you turn time backwards, the spin goes in the other direction, but the charges don't move. Okay, and so you have, in this case, you have a particle with an electric dipole moment and a spin that are aligned. In this case, you have them anti-aligned. So these should be two distinguishable particles. And so if you go out and look for a neutron or an electron, you should see distinguishable neutron and electrons with both. We don't see. The Pauli principle electrons, you only can put two electrons that spin up and spin down. If this was present, you could put four electrons in a particular state. We don't see that. And so the existence of the electric dipole moment would violate time reversal and therefore CP. You have to be careful. We said before there is charge parity violation in the weak interaction. Couldn't that give a background? Could we see electric dipole moments already because of this standard model? Turns out it's really hard to do it. So I have a Feynman diagram. This is one of the simplest Feynman diagrams for producing an electric dipole moment. This is a down quark here with seven virtual particles successfully produce in the standard model an electric dipole moment. All of these particles, every time you have an extra one, you have to pay the cost of the weak interaction, especially here, 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 here. All that weak interaction makes it smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and knocks it down. And so it's extremely small. It's many orders of magnitude. It's 6 or 7 orders of magnitude smaller than the present limit. And so there's huge room for discovery before you'll even see the standard model. So that's actually good news. However, if there are new particles, whether they are this supersymmetry or some other kind of new particles, if they have a charge parity violation, these new particles, you can flicker into this d-twiddle and chi-twiddle for a very short time. This can produce at one of these points here CP violation and therefore electric dipole moment. The fact that this is so small means if you go out and make a measurement of an electric dipole moment, if you see one, it's new physics, because we're not in anybody's lifetime, I don't believe, we'll have enough sensitivity to actually see this process. So it's all discovery if we find an electric dipole moment in all the new experiments for the next 30, 40, 50 years. And so how did it start? Well, it actually started at the lab here. Ed Purcell and Norman Ramsey had an idea to look for a neutron electric dipole moment. They realized that in 1950, they published a paper saying, if there's an electric dipole moment, I didn't mention it, but it also violates parity. Okay, so maybe you could discover parity violation by looking for an electric dipole moment. So they looked and didn't see it. Okay, so they said, well, we didn't expect it, so no big deal. And they did this by a neutron beam magnetic resonance here at the laboratory. Picked up by the press, this major publication here, talked about how Harvard University comes to Oak Ridge to collaborate to look for a neutron with a permanent electric dipole moment. Here is the graduate student here, Mr. Smith, and then Purcell and Ramsey sent him there to do the experiment. The interesting thing, if you notice, I said the experiment was done actually in 1950, I think Smith actually got his PhD in 1950. 7 years later, they published the paper. Turned out that what they said in the paper was the experiment was completed several years ago. However, the negative results are what we expected, so we didn't think it was interesting. Because they didn't expect parity violation, they were looking for it in case, didn't see it. However, 6 years later, it was predicted that parity would be violated. The next year, in 57, it was observed in different interactions. So they discovered parity violation. All of a sudden, it was a big thing. And the fact that parity could be broken, both Ramsey and Purcell realized, well, the electric dipole moment violates parity and charge parity. And so maybe if parity is broken, we should look for charge parity. And so they said, let's publish our result, because they were able to estimate from a previous neutron scattering experiment what the limit on the electric dipole moment is. Their measurement was 100 times better, so they said, let's publish it, and they did. So how do you make a measurement? I want to first quickly describe how you make a measurement of electric dipole moment. You want to have, the electric dipole moment points along the spin is related to the magnetic moment. And so the magnetic moment likes to precess in a magnetic field. And so you can put a particle. So I have the electric and magnetic fields pointing in. I rotate the spin to be 90 degrees to the fields, the magnetic field and the electric field here. And so the particle starts to precess. That precession can be speeded up or slowed down if I turn on an electric field and the particle has an electric dipole moment. So if I have an electric dipole moment, that frequency can get a little faster when I flip the electric field. Now it's coming out of the paper. Now it's going into the paper. Now it's coming out of the paper. So it speeds up or slows down depending on the direction of the electric field. And so this is how you would search for it. However, you have to be extremely careful. That frequency obviously depends on the magnetic field, both on the time variation and also on the spatial variation of the magnetic field. It can cause systematic false effects. And so you have to correct for all these effects. So you have to be very careful about your magnetic fields. So the experiment of Ramsey and Purcell is actually here. So they published it in 57. As I said, there was an earlier experiment they reanalyzed to get a limit here. And so they measured this. Norman Ramsey continued to work on the electric dipole moment, pushing it farther and farther down. It turned out there was lots of theoretical ideas. Once the parity violation was discovered, theorists said, well, maybe let's try to make charge parity violated. So they came up with theories. And the theories would have a particular electric dipole moment, and then bang, it would not be observed. Bang, not observed, not observed, not observed. And so all these theories were getting beaten up. They were not valid because they predicted too big of an electric dipole moment. And so it kept getting smaller and smaller. Although you'll notice it's kind of starting to flatten out. This is the range, so the mass of the particle that flickers in to produce, I showed you these particles that have to flicker in, virtual particles, to produce the electric dipole moment. This, about 200 times the mass of the proton is this limit. We'd like to go up to about 50,000 times the mass of the proton down to here. That requires an improvement of about a factor of 100 in the electric dipole moment, and that also is the range where this matter-antimatter asymmetry could be explained. And so for the neutron, at least, it turns out that the science is so strong. There are many places around the world that are trying to improve on the neutron's electric dipole moment in Japan, in Europe, in Canada, and in the US, in particular at the spallation neutron source. And I'll talk a little bit about the experiment that's underway here. So the experiment, we saw NEDM at SNS, it's funded by the National Science Foundation and the Department of Energy through the Nuclear Physics Divisions. It's based on a concept from Bob Golub and Steve Lamoureux, where if you put enough things together, you can dramatically improve the sensitivity to the electric dipole moment. And so, in particular, the experiment uses, you need lots of neutrons to have high sensitivity. So it uses cold neutrons, in this case from the SNS. You scatter the cold neutrons from superfluid helium. The phonons in the superfluid helium, the little vibrations in the superfluid helium, cause the neutrons to get really slow. And when they're really slow, they can be trapped inside a box. And so we keep them inside a box to measure this precession that I described. We also, in order to get high sensitivity, you need the bigger the electric field, the bigger the frequency change will be. So you want a big electric field. Since we're using liquid helium already, we can use liquid helium as an insulator to put very high electric fields on the neutrons. We also have to worry about the magnetic effects I described. And in this case, we're using a polarized helium-3. Polarized helium-3 is mostly a polarized neutron, but it's in an atom. Okay, so the two protons pair off in the helium-3, but the polarized neutron is there. So it has an EDM too, except it's got an electron cloud from the atom. That electron cloud shields the electric field. So if you put on a big electric field, the neutron doesn't see it. And so the electric dipole moment for the helium-3 is 100,000 times smaller than the neutron. So it's a great way of measuring magnetic effects rather than EDM. So you can separate out the magnetic disturbances from the electric field case. Also, since we're cold anyway, we're cryogenic, we can use superconductors to eliminate external fields. We then measure the precession frequency in two different ways. Both review committees and some of our competitors have said we are probably the most ambitious NEDM experiment that is currently underway. We would have a sensitivity at the level of 2×10⁻²⁸ in about 3 calendar years. So, here's the collaboration. It's something like 20 institutions. This was at one of our meetings near Caltech. You'll notice we have our safety officer present to make sure we're operating in a safe manner. we had a good time there. The experiment locally, this is again on flight path 13. Cold neutron beam enters into our experiment. The present concept for the experiment, it's a giant cryogenic experiment. We need to have some vertical space, and so we're actually proposing a small new building with a below ground level floor in order to mount the experiment. So the experimental guts are here. Cold neutrons come. I'll blow it up so you can see what's going on. So the cold neutrons in this case are coming into the paper here, and we have two. We have a high voltage here, and then two ground electrodes, which provide the electric field in one direction and the other direction. And then if I blow it up, you can see here's where the neutrons live inside this cell. Here's a high voltage electrode, and here's a ground electrode. Here's another one. And so this part here is actually the system that produces the polarized helium-3 and injects it into the other part of the experiment. And so it's as I said, one of the most ambitious. One of the reasons one of the most ambitious experiments is because it's extremely technically challenging. From the cryogenic point of view, we need 1,200 liters of superfluid helium at half a Kelvin in order to produce the neutron flux that we need. We obviously must minimize heat sources in order to keep that helium cold. We need, in order to measure the precession, we will have alternating current magnetic fields. Those alternating current magnetic fields create eddy currents in metals. And so we can't have conductors, or essentially no conductors in the measurement region. We also need a large cooling plant to produce all this helium and keep it cold. We are highly sensitive to magnetic field variations and gradients. We need magnetic shielding. We also have to characterize the magnetic fields so that we know that they're spatially uniform to levels of part per million per centimeter. Also, in order the experiment requires that we actually operate. So that uniformity has to be preserved at very low field. It's 3 microtesla, which is much less than the Earth's field. So we're shielding out the Earth's field, and we want to have very high electric fields. Again, in order to get the 75 kilovolt per centimeter, we need to put in more than 600 kilovolts into a cryogenic environment and maintain it. And so these are the technical challenges which we are addressing. So how do we get there? So presently, the experiment is in a demonstration phase where we demonstrate a number of the critical components, the high voltage, the polarized helium-3, the magnetic fields, for example, plus other key milestones. In fact, on site, Vincenziolo's group is looking at light producing the signal, which is how we tell that the neutrons are precessing. We're going to detect some light, and he's developing the light detection at very low temperatures. So we hope this critical component demonstration phase will end at the end of next year. We will then begin a large-scale integration where we start bringing the components together and start integrating them into an experiment. That will follow, as well as the construction of the new building, we hope, in 2018. We will begin actually taking, we hope to take data as soon as 2019 in a test setup in the existing building. There's already an existing building for the fundamental neutron beam line. We'd like to put a test set up there as the new building with the reduced floor level is being built. And so then once that's finished, we could begin commissioning and data taking in 2020 and 2021. So I hope today I've identified how many different energy scales of the experiment can access the same physics, trying to predict or explain or account for very, very high energy particles. So the electric dipole moment, we're looking stuff off the chart here, which wouldn't even be accessible with this higher energy collider. And so it's clear that there are a number of experiments out there, and we're looking forward to some exciting results in the near future. Thank you.
We're just going to go sit down over here for Q&A. Okay, questions? And maybe while people are thinking of questions, I'll ask one, and it's good that you left this slide up here. Seems to me like there's kind of an anthropic principle at play here, which says that if there was stuff going on at the far left-hand side that did not manifest itself in the accessible region, you wouldn't care. And that it's only because it manifests itself in the region that we inhabit, you know, or at least the expanded experimental space, that we actually care. I mean,
you and I, for sure.
Yeah.
Experimentalists. The theorists still worry about if you're trying to understand the very early universe or something. You do want to know, you want to at least speculate about what's going on out there. But you're right, from the experimental point of view, the observable effects that we can measure will be in this range.
Well, and in some sense, as the cost of moving up the energy scale becomes more and more prohibitive, you know, I think you're almost forced to think about looking for those manifestations. Because actually, you know, all of the examples that you talked about are, relatively inexpensive on the scale of these things.
Right.
Yeah. You're talking millions to tens of millions versus billion for the Large Hadron Collider or the next accelerator, easily.
Let's see. Question over here with Ben.
When you mentioned sterile neutrinos, do I recall just in the last month or so that some sterile neutrino experiment in Antarctica was actually declared that they don't exist?
I haven't seen the day. I've heard about that, but I haven't looked at it in detail. I'd be surprised. In fact, our theoretical colleagues have talked about multi-sterile neutrinos. So I'm not sure they've ruled them all out. There's enough wiggle room for our theorist colleagues to rule stuff out. And again, a first evidence of ruling out often doesn't survive the long term. We'll see, but it's certainly interesting.
Does the decay of the neutron in this look for the neutron dipole moment, is that going to interfere with your?
Actually, the decay of the neutron is a background to us. When the neutron decays, the electron can produce a signal in our detection. The way we detect the neutron's precession is we use the neutron captures on the helium-3 in a spin-dependent way. It likes to capture with a particular spin orientation, doesn't like to capture in the opposite orientation. And so we look at this oscillating signal to measure the precession frequency, and then we're looking for the change in that frequency as the electric field switches. So the neutron beta decay is actually a background, but it's relatively small. We think we can easily separate it from the actual signal.
See, other questions? Up above.
Oh, there.
Hi. So I want to know what's your take on supersymmetry, because according to the previous predictions, the LHC should already have seen at least some signs of superparticles, but so far they have seen nothing. And second thing is, so there's a big, huge debate in China on whether China should build next generation collider, and some physicists support to build it, and some are opposed to it, including the Nobel physics laureate Xian Yan. He says it's not worth it.
I don't want to actually get into the political question of the cost for the science. The issue of the supersymmetric particles not being found yet at LHC, of course the theoretical predictions would be initially, you'd say, at the low energy end, but there's a range that's possible. In fact, supersymmetry is still viable up to several times the LHC energy, which is why people are thinking about going beyond the LHC, going six or maybe 10 times higher than the LHC, which, for example, in China. And so I think there is still strong motivation. I mean, especially not to push our own stuff, but if one of these low energy experiments saw something, and for example, the electric dipole moment, if it would found, say, another factor of 10 smaller than the present limit, it would suggest a mass of a particle about three times, just at the edge of what the LHC can see, or a little bit heavier. And so you could, if any experiments like that showed up, that would be very strong support for going ahead. But even in the absence of that, you would like to, if you can, explore it in a politically cost-effective way, I think it's worthwhile. And I know China is very, some in China are very enthusiastic about it.
So the question about the Chinese investments prompts a question in a different direction, since you're from Caltech. Next week, I'm going to Shanghai, where there's a symposium. You know, the Chinese government has declared that they're going to build some number of what they're calling comprehensive national labs, similar to the national labs at the U.S. And the one that's proposed in Shanghai is also co-located with a new university called Shanghai Tech, which is explicitly sort of advertised as a Caltech-like model. And of course, Caltech is a very special and unique place. I think certainly, even within the US system, where there's some very great research universities, Caltech doesn't quite look like the standard model, if you will. So I'm curious, since you've
beyond the standard,
yeah, model, since you've spent the bulk of your career there, what do you think the prospects are for deliberately making a Caltech?
Well, that was certainly the intent of the founders, that they wanted to make something just like this, like Caltech, focused almost exclusively on science and technology, a very small student body, bringing in the best people, not large groups. There are individuals who can excel is what the goal of the founders was. And I think it was directed then, and China could do the same thing. If you can make it attractive enough to get the best people there, I think you can do it.
Other questions? Okay, well, if not, let's thank our speaker again. I'd also like to thank the organizers and all the participants, and just to remind you, the next Wigner lecture is going to be Chad Holliday on the 17th of October. Chad has Tennessee roots. He's actually a graduate of the University of Tennessee, but he's served major roles in industry, so we're sort of shifting gears from fundamental science to application. He had a long career in the chemical industry. He's been chair of the board of banks, and I think is now the chair of the board at Shell. He's also been very actively engaged in the national dialogue about the value of investments in R&D. So we'll be hearing from him on October 17th. And thank you all for coming.